Good morning, everyone. Imagine if you turned on the news on your television and they start out with, "Good morning, everyone. We have some tremendous good news for you today in our broadcast, so be sure to stay tuned." Okay, well, that's what we're saying here. I have some tremendously wonderful news to impart today. In fact, it's so wonderful, we want to start out with the mood of repentance, the confession. We have a severe continuity problem. Why? That centers us and stabilizes us so that we can bear the shock of the good news. The good news is quite stunning, quite stunning. So without being in too much of a hurry right now, we sort of calm down, we settle in, calm down and settle in. This is just, fantastic news this morning that I was able to reach another high water mark of clarity. And so much was clarified. And I just realized I've been on the right track all along, which is great news. And it's pointing in a tremendous direction. So as we settle in, relax a little bit and say, okay, this is an ordeal of continuity fear where we're going to make great advances and then we're going to be like, wow, that was like really shocking. that's where we're at. And this is the discipline that's necessary, because the whole spiritual path is about absorbing the great good news. That's what it's about. The news is fantastically great. It's not about some bad news. It is about, it's the gospel. Gospel means good news. It is tremendous, great, and good news. And yet we're so used to bad news, to problems and stuff. We can hardly absorb it. Just say, wow, that's amazing. Okay. So I don't know how this will come out. I'm just freewheeling it, as always. In previous videos, I've said several things, that this nature, this world is like an attempt at oblivion. It's an attempt at problem solving. But I actually have got a further clarification on this, which was just wow, wow. It's actually a exercise, this world, these bodies, nature, all of nature, is an exercise in threat identification. And problem solving is actually the proof that we've correctly identified the threat. You see, that's the additional clarification that I was missing. I knew I was missing a little something. Like, wow, this all just fits, just clicked in. The whole scenario now clicked in. And it's easy as 1, 2, 3. If you can see it, the steps. One, we wanted to be greater than God, separate from God. Well, this actually, if we could do it, is actually, this desire is a threat of the oneness of God. It says, well, I want to threaten the oneness of God. This desire threatens the oneness of God. If we can separate from God, we have destroyed the oneness. So this desire is like a threat to God, making a threat. It's an empty threat, but still it's a desire to threaten the oneness of God. When we have this desire, when Spirit has this desire to threaten the oneness of God, what arises then is utter chaos, endless chaos, because we desire to see, to identify that we're able to threaten God, reality, oneness. And our desire to see how are we threatening? Where's the threat? Okay, how are we succeeding? We're not succeeding at all. But our desire to see success means that we can't identify where the threat is. We can't see it. Where is it? This results in mental chaos, total chaos that seems to go on endlessly, because reality is endless. And as we try to identify where's the threat, it seems to just be Our desire to find what is not there is symbolized as this total chaos, because at least we say, well, I just can't see where it is, but there's, you know, it's got to be somewhere. I just don't know where. That's what happens to us. This experiencing of utter chaos, endless utter chaos, arises for us. That's step two. Step three is we defend against that. It's a horrible, horrible experiencing. So we say, whoa, no, that I can't find it. But let's work on finding it. This chaos is too much. Let's have a scenario where we work on identifying threat. Okay. That scenario is what we call nature. The scenario is nature. Okay. Mother Nature is, we dream up Mother Nature as an endless, infinite generation of threat. In nature, everything is under constant threat. Okay. There's all these forces, you know, heat and cold, all different pressure gradients, right? All different pressure gradients here. Everything is pressuring everything in nature. Everything is threatening everything. And our bodies are extremely threatened. We come here. And what we do is we identify threats. And then we work to solve them. But the reason why we come here is not to solve the threat so much, but to identify them. Because we want to become experts in identifying threat. Okay. So then we think we can finally be able to look at this chaos and be able to identify how it is we're able to threaten God. See, we want evidence that we're able to threaten God. So it means we're greater than God. We can threaten the oneness. We can't find the evidence. So we dream up Mother Nature, and where we spend all this time identifying threats, so that we can believe, we can get enough learning and enough expertise, and so that we can eventually look at this chaos and say, ah, I see the threat has to be right there. This is what is out. It's 1, 2, 3. And I've been able to see this just simply and clearly and just say, wow, that's the whole thing right there. So what we do with our lives is we identify threats. And of course, in order to identify a threat, you have to have something that is being threatened. So bodies, these biological forms we call life forms, are under threat constantly. Everything is, the plants are under threat, even the minerals, everything is under this constant threat of pressures, forces of nature. And we try to identify the threat and solve the threat, resolve it. It's this resolving which then is the evidence that the threat was there. It's proof that yes, there was a threat because I was able to solve it. See, if we can't solve, we say, well, maybe the threat is, you know, we can't really quite identify it properly. But the solving threats means we've gone through the whole process of identifying properly the threat. This activity of ours of identifying threats is what we call hell, is what we call hell, actually. This is hell. Mother Nature is hell. 100%. And you're listening, always practice the full stop method, which is when you hear something like that, Mother Nature is hell, just full stop it. Don't think about it. Don't struggle with it. Don't argue with it. Don't extend it. Just let it reverberate. Now, we're going to expand upon all this. This is the basic framework. But we're going to talk about what is salvation then. And I will tell you what salvation is. We found out what the activity of hell is. And let us first start by realizing we have been engaged with trying to identify threat for so long, to try and then be able to look at total chaos, endless, utter chaos, and identify that there is a threat there, so that we can then believe that we're greater than God, you see. We've been engaged with that for so long that to simply drop all this effort to identify threat, which would include dropping the body, all forms, the whole world, the whole universe, all Mother Nature, poof, gone, the dream. No need for it to arise as appear at all. There's just appearance. All this form of just appearance. Well, we are too frightened for that magnitude of a continuity leap. Suddenly, all form, all threat, vanish forever like it never was. Well, we could do that. But we're not going to do it because of what I call the continuity fear. The continuity problem is this great fear, like, whoa, that's just too much of a leap to take. So what do we do? What if we repent? Now, repentance means to say, wow, God, I'm tired of this stupidity. I want to recognize I can't threaten reality. I want to stop this mad desire to be greater than you, separate from you, and therefore I don't need to see this chaos. I don't need to identify threat. I don't need to be engaged with this anymore at all. I've repented. I've changed my mind. I've changed my desire. Repentance, a change of mind, a change of desire. I no longer desire to try and be greater than God. Now, if we truly repented, and we could literally be done with this instantly. But the continuity fear keeps us saying, no, it's too fast. So God understands the continuity fear. He says, yes, we have this problem of continuity issue. So there is a plan of salvation to deal with this continuity fear. This is the plan of salvation. And that there's an intermediate step, which enables us to keep the forms that we're used to. That Mother Nature has these forms that are constantly under threat, basic parameters of what we're used to here. We are able to keep those forms, except they're not under any threat whatsoever. Okay. Just take that full stop there, because we're taking leaps here. Big steps. We're able to see the forms of what we're used to, except these forms are not under the slightest threat whatsoever. There are no forces pressuring anything. They're just perfect appearances in vibrant, beautiful way. How is this possible? What is giving rise to these forms? Love. The only force there is love. And it's love that sustains all these forms, these beautiful forms we're used to. And nothing is threatened in the slightest bit. There is not a slightest threat anywhere. You say, well, it sounds like paradise. It is. It is paradise. We really, our choice is really between hell and paradise. That's the only choice we have. We can continue to identify threats, which is hell, or we can dwell in paradise where there are no threats. There are no threats to identify. Now, we might say, well, wow, everybody wants to go to paradise, not so fast. Those who feel that their happiness depends on identifying threat properly. If they found themselves in paradise, they would freak out and they'd say, this is hell. There is no threat here. I'm going back to hell where I can identify threat, because that's the only way that I can be saved. That's their belief. So you have these two different belief systems of what salvation is. Most still believe that hell is salvation. That is why they still cling to it. There are others, such as myself, who believe that paradise is salvation. And I only cling to hell because of the continuity fear. You see, then there's that group. Now, how we think of like trees here. They're sustained, well, you know, water, nutrients, you know, biology sustains all these life forms here and the ecosystems. But in paradise, everything is directly sustained by love. The tree does not have to have water. The tree does not have to have nutrients. It's love that is sustaining the appearance. It's just an appearance. Just like everything here is actually an appearance too. But it gets more complicated here because we want to see threat. So we have all this imagined process that's taking place. It's just the way that we've structured appearance here. A very complex dream. Like a painter can paint a picture of a landscape, right? And look at it and say, oh, it's beautiful. But it's just paint on canvas, right? It's still beautiful. Well, love can give rise to forms that we're used to, nature forms. But it's just pure love is there in appearing as all these forms without any threat of sickness, aging, no threats whatsoever to its, you know, vibrant beauty, flawlessness. Everything's absolutely flawless and effortlessly flawless. It's all just one solid block of appearance from the love. Love gives rise to it. This is paradise. This is paradise. Now, getting into paradise, let's say we want to. Those who believe that hell is salvation, they believe in learning more and more and more how to identify threats better and better and better. And they gain what's called status through this, which is why hell is all has this huge hierarchy of status in it, of how advanced are you in identifying threat. And they believe that you basically claw your way up this vast spiritual corporate ladder where you become more and more adept at identifying threat by proving how you're able to dispel it, you see. So in the ideology and belief system of hell, that hell is salvation, they believe that works are salvation. You attain salvation through what's called works. By your work, by your identifying threat and proving that you did actively by solving the threat. So people who believe that hell is salvation are very active in solving problems, identifying threat, trying to solve problems, helping others. Like, oh, these are problems. Let me help you with this problem, this problem, this problem. They're very active that way. And they feel that that will eventually get them up to a point, you know, where they're able to identify the threat to reality properly. And therefore, really be greater than God, actually, is what that would amount to. Except there is no threat to reality. So it's just this endless corporate ladder that you're constant, just, it goes on and on and on, identifying more and more threat, more and more threat, more and more threat, trying to, you know, figure out how to resolve the threat, etc. Leads nowhere, actually. But there is this whole status thing of getting better, getting better. It's through works, they believe it's through works. Now, as far as paradise goes, getting into paradise is entirely through grace. It has absolutely nothing to do with your problem solving or your threat identification ability. Nothing to do with it. Entirely through grace, it is simply there for you. We are the sonship of God. We are one with all reality. We were created as reality. So, of course, God has total love for us, and we don't have to earn anything. We have perfect status with God, with reality. Perfect status. So, of course, this intermediate step, which we need to resolve the continuity problem, of course love provides this for us without any need for us to have a resume or prove our worthiness of it. We're inherently worthy of it. We are reality. We're completely loved by all of reality, totally. So, and we can never separate from that. So because we have this continuity problem, love is, you know, eager to provide paradise for us. And has. And we don't need to do a thing to earn it whatsoever. How can we earn it? The only way of earning anything is to identify threat in this nature. Identify threat and solve problems. Like, prove that we identified problems and threat. We don't need to do any of that. We are inherently welcome in paradise. All we have to do is repent for paradise. Now, being Jesus on the cross being crucified, which shows the threat. What we're involved in here is the threat of Mother Nature crucifying everything. Actually, Mother Nature is a crucifixtress, crucifies everything. Everything is being ceaselessly crucified by Mother Nature. Jesus on the cross depicted this. The resurrection depicted supernature, which is paradise, which is completely sustained by love. Appearance, all appearances, one force, no other, which is just love sustaining all appearances and form, all forms of appearance there, dwelling in paradise. That's salvation, dwelling in paradise. That resolves the continuity problem for us. Now, there were thieves on either side of the cross. Okay, one thief, or thieves and murderers, very, you know, people who, you know, were being crucified. And one of them was screaming at Jesus, "Hey, save yourself. Can't you see the threat that you're in? If you're the Son of God, you should be able to solve this problem. Come on." Jesus said, "No, not, you know, just." So that one was very angry and spitting and mocking and cursing at Jesus, saying, you know, you're a liar. You're not solving this problem. If you should be able to solve this problem." And the other thief, criminal, said, "Hey, no, I get what you're about. I understand what you're about. I get, I accept it, I repent." And Jesus said, "Boom, you'll be in paradise with me. You will be in paradise with me." This is very powerful teaching. Very powerful teaching. I know the atheists will say, "Well, there was no Jesus." Well, look at it this way. If they want to look at it that way, okay. It doesn't detract from the power of the teaching, because it's accurate teaching. It's accurate teaching. What this teaches is salvation is not by works, it's by grace. And that you're either in hell or in paradise. That's the choice we have. That's it. And so it's very accurate teaching. All we have to do to go to paradise is repent and say, "Wow, okay, I accept this through grace, the grace of God." And again, there are no threats in paradise. So if you are looking for status, you won't want to be there. There's no way to gain status in paradise, because there's no threat. What are you going to do? Say, "Hey, I identified a really big threat here. And I found a way to solve it." It means I really identify. People say, "Oh, you're really, that's high status. That's great." There are no threats in paradise. So there isn't any way to attain any status there. All are equal there. All are equal. Now, the Eucharist, I'm seeing in Catholic Mass, is a symbol of paradise, actually. It's unleavened bread, which means no yeast has been added to it. Okay. Now, dough which yeast has been added to, what happens to it? Rises. It bubbles. You know, you cook it, it's all full of bubbles. And it that symbolizes the forces of pressure in Mother Nature. Okay? It symbolizes Mother Nature and all of the constant forces that are at play, chaotic, constant, threatening forces, right? Conflictual. All nature's in conflict with all these forces, constituting threat to everything. That's what it symbolizes. The unleavened bread means no forces at all, just love. Just love. That's paradise. So the Eucharist actually symbolizes paradise. I don't know how much that's being taught, but that's how I see it, actually. Unleavened, just one force, love, giving rise to all appearances. No pressure. Everything is absolutely peaceful, absolutely calm, absolutely peaceful. No threat anywhere, ever. There's no storms coming. There are no earthquakes ever happen. There's no pestilence. There's no famine. There's no drought. There is simply absolute, beautiful peace and serenity and calm. Unleavened. See, it's totally unleavened. There is no yeast causing all this commotion at all. It's unleavened bread. That's paradise. Do we have to die to get into paradise? No, actually not. You can. We can actually see supernature here with spiritual vision, and that is, we can actually, to some extent, if you're really far along, you in the continuity sphere, you've dropped a lot, most of it. You can probably see supernature almost all the time here, and those who have no continuity sphere can see supernature all the time here. If you see a tree, for instance, instead of, well, when we're here seeing nature, seeing a tree, instead of seeing that tree, we can see that tree as a form, love, the love-based form of that tree. We can see that instead. And, you know, the sidewalk, we can see the love-based sidewalk. So everything seems like immaculately beautiful and pure and unthreatened. Even while we're in the world, we can have spiritual vision like this. And certainly, after we depart this world, we can go straight to the death-free realm, as I call it, which is paradise, actually, the paradise realm. This is salvation. Okay. Now, let's see what questions may arise here. Without struggling with this, it's just full stopping it. We don't need to, you know, dive in and say, well, wait a minute, let me see what kind of problems can... See, that obviously interferes with the absorption of it. Let's say we took a medicine that needs to be absorbed properly, and they say, don't eat this food because that blocks the absorption of the medicine. Okay, we take the medicine, and then we start getting cold feet and saying, wow, I don't know if I really want to get free of this threat to my health here. And then you eat that food that you weren't supposed to eat, and it blocks the absorption of the medication. It's like that. Our thinking about it can block the absorption of this information, which is why it's very tough to get this information. It's easy to block it, very easy to block it. So you have to be determined to not eat that food of thinking. Okay, now wait a minute. Now, how do I apply it here? No, it's true. What we're talking about here is true. So you don't have to worry about is it true or not. What we're really looking for is the threat, right? When we start thinking, we're saying, okay, let me identify the threat. Okay, there must be some threat to this, right? That's what thinking's all about, identifying threat. We don't need to think about paradise. There's no threat there. We simply experience it. So for every aspect of this world, whatever we're seeing as Mother Nature, love flawlessly supplies its appearance as a substitute for it. Where it's just love that's sustaining the appearance instead of all these forces of nature sustaining the appearance. So we could see that. We can see that. We can choose. We choose between heaven and paradise and hell. I call it paradise. Heaven is too nebulous because it's often thought of as an afterlife state. You know, people say, well, after I died, I went to heaven. Or it's seen as the space, the cosmos, the universe. Now, we're talking paradise. We're talking about the realm that is directly and purely, all appearances are totally being given rise, our love-based appearances, 100%, being sustained just by love, and nothing, no other force, no forces at all, just pure, calm, peaceful, happy, blissful love, giving rise to all appearances. No threat anywhere whatsoever. And this resolves our continuity issue that we have. Now, what about activities in such a realm? Do we just sit there? Well, a lot of the time we can just sit there and enjoy it, but as far as our creative activities, what we do there collectively, those in paradise, they collectively practice co-creating with God, which is allowing creative expression from everyone there to the living light, which is love itself, manifests all the expressions, creative expressions, desires. It blends them all together, and then God adds harmony to all of that, and we can experience that as a beautiful, incredibly creative, beautiful display. As I liken it to like a courtyard, and we're sitting around like in a sort of like verandas, large arched verandas with a roof over, and kind of we're sitting around this inner courtyard of a home, and there's like there's a pool, big pool in the middle of the courtyard, and we're sitting around this pool, and this pool is where this like liquid living light manifests whatever our creativity wants to manifest as in beauty. And it's both, we experience both our individual contribution to it as well as the collective contribution, as well as the harmonizing contribution of God. And so we're able to just, whatever we can express creatively, what we are seeing is way, way more beautiful than our own individual efforts could reach. It's also even more beautiful than our collective efforts, because God is harmonizing with it. So in paradise, that's what I see the activity, is what we do, is we simply create and allow the living light to manifest this beautiful play of manifestation. And then appearances rise and they subside back into the pool. You see, it's like the water comes like a fountain out of the pool, manifests this beautiful display, and then you can go back into the pool like that. And so we practice co-creating with God like that. That's the activity. There are no threats to identify, you see. And living in this world, we say, what will we do with our time? There's no threats, no threat to our survival, no threats. What will we do? Well, co-creating with God, this beautiful display is just like mind-blowing. You know, it's just so, so beautiful. And the beauty goes on and on and on and on, and you get better and better and better at it. And then eventually, you get so good at this, you don't even need a world of form anymore. You see, that's how you graduate from paradise, actually. Eventually, you graduate from paradise, even. And that's beyond anything we can talk about here, where we are right now, which is hell. Again, Mother Nature is hell. There's no two ways about it. It's a purely defensive maneuver, fear-based, entirely fear-based, trying to identify threat so then we can be able to find in total, utter, endless chaos where the threat is. And then therefore it won't be chaotic anymore, and therefore we'll be able to enjoy our separation from God. That's what this is all about. So it turns out the teachings of Jesus are correct. It turns out that a lot of the basic teachings of Christianity are correct. And salvation is through grace. We do choose between heaven and hell, as they call it, or I call it paradise and hell. That's the only choice we have. It's the only choice we have. We either remain in threat identification, or we go to a realm where there are no threats to identify. Either remain in hell or go to paradise. Again, full stop on this information, where we just don't do anything to block the absorption of it. And so, just how great is it to turn on your television set, turn on your computer, and here's the news, you know, here's the news. I mean, it's way better than following the news of an earthquake, isn't it, which we just had up in Napa here, Napa, California. Fairly large one, but it's like not even a blip on my radar screen, because this morning I had this tremendously great news of salvation. Now, what about our problems here in the world, that we're so into identifying threat that our lives are very problematical, like mine right now, actually, which is the pressure of this world is to say, hey, you want to have status here? They say, we won't listen to you unless you have status. Okay, this is what the world says. If you, even if you come into this world to teach the truth, the world will say, yeah, you don't have any status, you haven't earned any status. You have to earn status through solving problems, which means identifying threat, and then solving them, which means you correctly identified the threat. So I said, wow, I tried to teach people, and no, they wouldn't listen. So I said, okay, I'm going to gain tremendous status in this world. And at that point, I was plunged into problems. And I just had massive problems my whole life trying to gain enough status so that people would listen to what I had to say. Now, they still don't listen to what I have to say because I haven't gained high enough status. In fact, there is no status you can ever gain in hell where anybody's going to listen to what you have to say about paradise, the truth, because they don't believe it, because it threatens them. They feel very threatened by it. So really, the only ones you can teach are the repentant ones, those who have repented, those who have hit rock bottom, and they say, you know what, this whole hell thing, it doesn't work for me. It's not going to work. It doesn't work. What do I do? So I have all these problems now because I intentionally attracted them to myself in order to gain status so people would listen to what I had to say. And what do you do when you repent and you choose paradise? Which means no threat. And you drop working on problems. You say, working on problems is really threat identification. Well, what I understand, what I truly hope, and I believe it is true, is the Holy Spirit takes care of, turn your problems over to the Holy Spirit. It will take care of them. That's part of its job. For those who are going to paradise, the Holy Spirit takes care of their worldly problems that arise. So that you don't have to be in this problem-solving mode, which is really threat identification mode, actually. Oh yeah, I have these bills. How much are the bills? How am I going to pay the bills? What exactly is a threat if I don't pay them? You know, this is threat identification, which is trying to gain status in hell. So when we turn our problems over to the Holy Spirit, what we're really turning over is our status. We're saying, I'm not interested in any status in hell. And that's why we don't turn our problems over, is we still are clinging to say, well, maybe if I just gain more status, people will listen to me. No, that's never worked. It's never worked. And so, yeah, I have to make a decision. We all do. Is will we keep clinging to threat identification in order to gain status, or do we turn our problems over to the Holy Spirit and say, okay, you solve them for me. I don't even have to know how you solve them. It's irrelevant to me. I don't even care. I'm not interested in threat identification anymore. So this is the quandary. Because I always think, wow, if I just manage to get out of this, you know, some way, then people will say, wow, look at you. What a great recovery. You solved that problem. You solved that threat, and you must have really properly identified it. Okay, that's some more status for you. Man, that's the big mistake we make here. That's the one I certainly made, and still suffering from it. Is I said, wow, nobody listens here, so I'm going to gain like ultimate status here, and then everybody will have to listen. And you see, you're thinking, that's what else can you try to do? You think, wow, these people, no one's going to listen here. So this is a decision, and I believe once I make the right decision, then the Holy Spirit will certainly take care of my problems for me in the world. Jesus says, don't give any thought to the problems of the world at all. That's the Holy Spirit's job. Holy Spirit's in charge of space and time and hell, this dream of hell. It's in charge of winding it all down as we each turn our problems over the Holy Spirit, our threat of identification over the Holy Spirit. It then, we don't need that time, we don't need the space for that to happen. So it's able to wind the dream down. Okay, it's able to do that. I don't need the time, I don't need the space for any problems or to arise for me whatsoever. So the Holy Spirit's able to shrink time through miracles like that. That's its ability. So we should all keep this in mind, because this is a major stumbling block we have. The ego mocks us and says, oh, you see, no one's listening to you. If you had status, they would listen. No, because the higher up in status you go, the problem, threat identification, the more investment you have in in salvation through works. And so if I say there's no salvation through works, it's entirely by grace, they say, ah, well, you know, you need more status, and maybe you'll think differently about it. You need to identify threat, like we have, you know. You haven't even started identifying threat. Who are you to talk? that kind of thing. Well, Jesus, just went away. Okay. Now, if I don't know how much of this video I lost the last segment because the camera malfunctioned. I don't know if you got any of this I was talking about. Hey, wait a minute. I don't know if I can turn. I may have lost all this taping. Well, I got like 48. Well, I got some of it. I don't know how much I got of it. Anyway, I'll figure out how much I got of it, and I'll do a follow-up on this, depending on how much I actually taped here. Okay. Very great. That's it. Now, I know it seems to be a lot more exciting to be watching earthquake news or something, but is it really? Or is it more exciting to actually be, to find out how you can qualify or how you can get into paradise? Which is more exciting news, actually? I've said that we don't need any resume. We don't have to have any status in this world and at all to get into paradise. But what about the status of understanding how deception works? That's a question. Do you really need that to get into paradise? I'm not sure about that. Probably not. Probably not. It's just we realize we don't need illusion of threat anymore. All threat is an illusion. Now, it may seem interesting to look at this. But as far as needing to understand it, probably not. Probably not. It might not hurt to understand it. What we call nature is just some arbitrary rules that we've established for appearance, which actually we've just made them up. And we agree, in order to assess threat, we have to agree on the rules of appearance. That means that something which is appearing through pressure, the appearances here, seem to be generating appearances, but really these are arbitrary rules we've made up. And something appears in a certain place for a certain duration. But really, anything can appear anywhere with any duration. There are no rules for appearance. Where appearance is completely free, we're free to experience any appearance we want to, or disappearance we want to. But when we come to Mother Nature, this is just a collaborative agreement that we're seeing in order to pretend that there's such a thing as threat. For instance, if we cut down a tree, we say that that something has happened to the appearance. Well, the appearance has changed, but nothing has happened to appearance itself. See, you cannot influence appearance itself. So, if we cut down a tree, the appearance has just changed of the tree, actually. And if we wanted to, we can just have the tree appear as it was before it was cut down. But we claim there's process here, which is not true. Appearance is not under any law of process in the slightest. We have made that up, totally made it up. So it can seem as though threat is possible. But if you could, you know, cut a tree in half and have it fall down and say the next moment, say, you know what, I think I'd like the appearance of a tree not being cut. The next instant, the tree is perfectly uncut there. What threat is there to the appearance of a tree, actually? Appearance can't be threatened, actually. But we have devised these parameters that we agree upon, so we all collectively go along with this. So it seems as though appearance can be threatened. That there's something called process, that appearance has to go along with this. No, this is entirely arbitrary that we have insisted that this is how we want to experience appearance. That doesn't mean this is how reality stipulates appearance. Reality is perfect freedom. So, whatever changes happen in appearance, we can reverse those changes instantly. or we're looking at this tree and we say, you know what? I don't want to see a tree there. Poof, it's no longer there. Oh, I think I'd better, I want the tree back. Okay, poof, it's back. And of course, having stipulated these imaginary rules of appearance in order to try to assess threat, we say it would be chaos if it was this way. See, and we think, oh, we can't have like that. It'd be complete chaos. Well, it would seem chaotic to the plan of assessing threat. It would be the end of the plan of assessing threat. It wouldn't be chaos. But the desire to hold on to it makes it seem like chaos. Whenever we're holding on to an illusion and insisting the illusion is true, the threat of losing the illusion seems to be chaos for us. Because we want to assess threat. Oh, what can harm a tree? Oh, you cut the tree down with a chainsaw. Wow, okay. That stipulates threat to the tree. We see the evidence the tree was threatened. And now you see that's the evidence of it. And the next moment you say, no, I want the tree to be in a perfect condition, not cut. Then it's perfect. Where's the threat? Where's the threat? Is the tree really threatened? No. So those who desire threat say, wait a minute. That's chaos. We can't determine, you know, we can't determine where the threat is, where threat is. Remember, threat is nowhere in reality. There is no threat to anything. But we want to assess threat. So we insist on what we think is process for appearance. But appearance is not bound one moment to the next at all. Our desire for experiencing is not bound one moment to the next. But we have collectively agreed to pretend that this is so. So we cut a tree down, we say, well, okay, the tree has been cut, and it cannot return to its previous state. It's impossible. Although we use surgery, you know, people lose various limbs and fingers, but they sew it back, put it back, right? but we have to go through all this process of putting it back. As I've said, sometimes the great yogis, there are stories of them, you know, losing limbs. There's someone hack their limb off, and they just pick it up and put it right back. It's just an appearance. They understand. It's just an appearance. Appearances aren't under any rules, except to appear exactly as we choose it to appear. Appearances, the living light presents to us exactly what we want to experience. So all of this Mother Nature is just a collective hallucination, insisting that there's these rules and laws which actually don't exist at all. And then the demand that everybody follow these rules here. Otherwise they're trying to plunge everyone into chaos, which of course isn't true. Because all it is to stay in the truth, there are no threats. Nothing is threatened. Nothing is threatened. Nothing real is threatened. Nothing unreal exists. All right, nothing real is threatened. Nothing unreal exists. That's the truth. So, but, you know, do we have to undo this in order to get into paradise? No. Do we have to really be an expert on it? Not really. It's just we realize we don't need it. We don't need it. Repentance is more like we don't need this collective agreement. We don't need to keep abiding by this collective agreement to imagine their imaginary laws, that somehow reality is bound by those laws. Remember, there's only reality. So we cannot bind reality to laws. We think that this is somehow separate, Mother Nature separate from reality, and that it's bound to the laws that we've decided for it, as if this appearance of nature is somehow separate from reality. It's not. It's just we collectively go along with this. Because we feel it's important to, in order to assess what, you know, assess threat, to be able to then organize chaos so that we can pretend to be greater than God. But, you know, like Jesus, he healed many people. How? Appearance. And it's just appearance. Someone appears with leprosy and says, I see you without leprosy. And they accept it, faith accepts it, that's okay to appear with, gone. All healing can be absolutely instantaneous, actually. But we want to determine threat So we want to see causation. There's no causation in appearance except our desire for it to appear a certain way. That's it. So if we want to appear as a leper, we appear the body's leprous. If we decide, no, I don't want to appear leprous anymore, the body can instantly appear non-leprous. Even the same thing with death. The body can be raised from death. I want the body to appear to be dead. I say, okay, I decide I don't want the body to appear to be dead. Raised from the dead like that. It's just all appearance. All this is just appearance. Appearance is not under any laws of process at all. There's no such thing as process. Reality is not bound by process. Reality is instantly responsive to what God and Spirit want to co-create. You see, the light is instantly responsive. Love and light is instantly responsive. And it's not set in anything. It's not set. Whatever it is that we want to extend. Nothing is ever lost in reality. See, nothing is ever lost. Nothing is ever lost. Whether it has an appearance or doesn't have an appearance. Whether it's manifest or unmanifest. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Nothing's ever lost. You cannot lose anything. All is always entirely in play. If we want to imagine a universe, boom, universe. If we want the universe to unmanifest, boom, like that. As far as appearance goes. Now, beyond that, it's not possible to talk about formlessness, complete formlessness. But we're talking about appearances, and no appearances are actually threatened at all. There is no threat. Reality cannot be threatened. Very important. We all just ask the light, love, the living light, we ask it to pretend, to present it as if there were laws. Okay, so light is doing this. But it's just a pretense. There aren't any such laws. And it's only our desire to identify threat that makes us scream with fear. Like if we didn't have this pretense of process, we wouldn't be able to determine threat at all. And so we think we'd be stuck with eternal chaos, which we would not, because we would repent and saying, hey, I don't want to try and be other than God, separate from all that is. So it wouldn't be chaos. Reality's not chaotic. But it's extremely difficult for us to accept this based on our long acquaintance with Mother Nature here. We think that this is the light, that reality operates under these laws. It does not. This is an extreme, bizarre request from us from light. To pretend it's not free, that we're not free, that appearance is governed by laws, by process, all this stuff. It's not true. It's not the slightest bit true. So this is just a completely bizarre, like hallucination, actually, what we're seeing. One moment. That's right. Mother Nature is a completely bizarre hallucination. It has nothing to do with reality. But the light, per our request, is putting on this pretense for us. And of course, it does it perfectly. So, can we see through it? Not really. You know, we need to more, it say we don't need it. We don't need it because, is it realistic? Absolutely, it's realistic. Absolutely, it's realistic. I mean, it appears real to us. It appears realistic. Is this the light that's doing this? Yes. Absolutely. So we take, this must be real. We forget our request of a light, don't we? Very conveniently forget that. If we forget that request we made of light, then we're really stuck. We're really stuck. That's why repentance is all important on the spiritual path. We need to realize, hey, I asked the light to present a scenario in which threat seems possible, so then I can work on identifying threat, right? So light says yes. Doesn't say no to us. Light says yes, 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 yes. So it is presented this scenario, Mother Nature. And when we forget this request we made, then really, we are truly stuck. We feel, wow, there's just no way out. No way out. You know, this is reality. This isn't reality. This is a bizarre request. Of course, it is appearing in reality. Sure, pure spaciousness. But it is an extremely bizarre request based on our whim of wanting to be separate from God, with the resultant inability to determine how we're threatening God. So we experience how we're threatening God is complete, utter chaos. We can't figure it out. Then request of, okay, we need a time, space, appearance. We need to be able to determine threat, you know. And so we have all these light pretending to be under, that appearance is under these laws of process. So that it seems like a tree, we can cut it down, and somehow that appearance then has been threatened. You know, has suffered from threat. And we don't realize we can just say, oh, light, I want to see the tree back perfect the way it was. Oh, okay. Now, very rarely does light do that. It can. Now, the parameters of this, of miracles here are under the, miracles are under the guidance of the Holy Spirit, actually, which miracles are helpful here. So we don't just go around, you know, replacing, healing people just like that, you know, because people would freak out. They may say, oh, great, I'm healed, but wait a minute, how'd you do that? What was the process? You know, no process, just an appearance. What? You know, no, you're threatening me with chaos. You know, so you see, we have a severe continuity problem here. And so you cannot just go around writing all the wrongs, like, you know, writing all the appearances of threat just instantly. Oh, you know, there's a whole forest that's been decimated by some beetle. Oh, you want the forest back? Okay, poof, there it is. Of course we could do that. Nothing's under any threat. But that would freak us out, because we'd say, you're threatening me with chaos now. It's absolute chaos. I need to determine threat. And you say, and I can see there isn't any. This is horrible. So miracles are under the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit is the one that gives out miracles. So we're not supposed to be doing miracles through our own will like this here. If miracles happen, the Holy Spirit wants, fine. It doesn't matter to me. I don't care one way or the other, actually. Whatever the Holy Spirit wants to do is fine with me. I'm not trying to do anything here, actually. I think this should be the attitude. I'm not trying to do anything. I'm not trying to give miracles like that one way or the other, because you don't know. We can't know every last detail of every situation, knowing where miracles are accepted and where others will freak them out and feel they're being threatened with chaos. You see? It's infinitely complex, actually. We don't need to be dealing with that. The Holy Spirit deals with that. So give all miracles over to the Holy Spirit. Say, Holy Spirit, whatever miracles you want to do in my name, I don't care. You can do whatever you want to do. I'm not attached to any of them. Okay, I'm not attached to any of them, because, you know, it's a piece of cake. Why should I take credit for some miracle? Because all of us, appearance is completely free. We're completely free. It's ridiculous to say, well, I did a miracle or something. What do you mean? You know, it's just I decided not to follow these arbitrary, bizarre, you know, laws. Well, so what? These laws aren't even laws at all. So, you know, the idea of thinking that doing miracles gives you some sort of status or something is just simply not true. So you do not need to be a miracle worker in terms of doing that. The miracles you see around some certain saints are only done by the Holy Spirit for those who have a particular need for that, a particular that would help them in some way. Otherwise, no, it's more subtle than that. It's much more subtle than that. Much more subtle. But certainly, they can. I mean, people ask saints for miracles all the time. Could you please heal this, heal this, heal this? Well, sometimes the miracles happen, sometimes they don't. But that has nothing to do, whether the miracle happens or not, has nothing to do with facts at all, that reality cannot be threatened. It just means the continuity fear is different in everyone, okay? So what happens for one person may not happen for another. That doesn't establish fact. It just establishes different levels of continuity fear. That's why continuity fear, this principle, is so important for clarity. Otherwise, you'll be confused. Be confused about how things work here. You know, one gets healed, and the other doesn't get healed. And they say, wow, one must be a sinner. One must be a bad sinner that didn't get healed. No, nobody's a sinner. One just has a more severe continuity fear than the other. The others have other has evaporated enough continuity fear, so being healed like that without any causation of nature doesn't bother them. They say, I have faith. That's why I say faith will make you whole, meaning you don't have to believe in the so-called principles of nature at all, because they're completely arbitrary. They're just it's a pretense. The nature, Mother Nature, is a total pretense. It's a dream. That's what they call it, a dream. Okay, we use the term a dream. We go to sleep. We just make up whatever we want to make up. See, this is the parameters of our dream. We're completely controlling the parameters, right? This is what we... Well, and the same thing in Mother Nature. It's just a dream. It's a collective dream. And we've been working on it for, you know, really intensely. And we really believe in it. We think we really have to have it. So it's a very intense dream. But it is 100% a dream. 100%. That's all it is, a hallucination, as it were, hallucinated dream of all these, you know, parameter of pretending there's process. Now, is the resurrection of the dead possible? Absolutely, it's possible. just appearances. The dead can be dead for millions of years, and if you want them to reappear in a certain way, they'll just reappear instantly. There's no process involved at all. Remember, there is zero process involved in reality. Zero. So, that is true. The only reality is real. Nothing unreal exists. So, there's zero process in Mother Nature, too, except it's this collective hallucination that wants to see it that way. Wants to see it that way. But interpreting that way doesn't make it so. But we, like good sheep, we go along with it because we think we need it. Why do we keep being fooled? We think we need it. Because how else can we identify threat unless there's some process? Unless we believe in process, right? In time and space and process. We see a like a flood. A river floods and it carries a house away, you know, how, and it pulls a house off its foundation. You see the house floating down the river. You say, oh my God, see, there's a threat. I see a threat to the house. We're seeing the evidence of the threat. So, time and space. The house was here at this time, and now the house is there down the river at this time. So we say, well, there's obvious evidence of threat. Well, we could just decide, you know what, I want the river to subside, and I want the house to be right back there, right now, and boom, that is so. So then where's the threat? Where's the threat, you see? Where's time and space? Where's time and space? So time and space, the belief in time and space are necessary to believe in threat, and work on that identifying threat, but nothing real is threatened, nothing unreal exists, is a key concept that Jesus brought forth in A Course in Miracles. Very, very key. But if we were to do that, then the other people wouldn't want that, and they'd say, hey, what happened to our threat? You know, we thought we really isolated the threat there. That's very important. That helps us grow in status and learning and stuff. And it's gone. You caused us to fall back down the pit. You know, we're climbing out of this pit of threat, of not being able to identify threat. We've been working for so long to get, you know, to be able to identify threat properly. And suddenly, you know, you pull the rug out from underneath us. So, you see? why paradise is necessary? Paradise is necessary because those who want to believe in threat have to have their realm, have to have their dream. You can't take the dream away from them. They will feel like you're plunging them into chaos, and then they'll dream even more intensely. So let those who want to dream of threat have their realm. Have Mother Nature. Welcome to it. It's not a problem. God bless everyone who wants that and have fun with it. But then those who realize they don't need threat, then they need a realm too. Because again, the continuity issue, you can't just leap right back into formlessness. You can, but we won't. It's too frightening. So we deserve a realm too. It was the paradise realm. Absolutely deserve the paradise realm, 100%. We're not supposed to attack this realm, so to speak. They think it's attack by just demonstrating miracles here. You know, the people know. They won't go for that. You know, if you have somebody who appears like to be 90 years old on their deathbed and they say, you know what? I'm not interested in this appearance anymore. I'm going to appear to be 25, perfectly healthy. Boom. They appear at 25, perfectly healthy. Get up out of the hospital and walk out. Do you really think that everyone will say, oh, that's great, no problem? No, everybody will completely freak out. They'll say, well, you're an imposter. What happened to the other body? You know, what'd you do with that? You know, you're not, you must have taken it away and killed them and put yourself here. What about the insurance? What's your identity? You know, no, they're just like a hornet's nest. Hornet's nest. There we go again. All right, back for a little break, but that's good because something came out. It was really wonderful. Now, one of the big objections I found in this world is, oh, people say, oh, you're going to paradise. How look good for you. Well, how selfish. You're leaving everybody else here to do the work that you should have done, which is to help us identify threat. So you're off on a wonderful vacation to paradise, and you're leaving us here to struggle and say, well, you know, figure out what the threat, you know, threat is. And they hate you for that. You know, you're just nothing but a lazy, no good, you know, won't help us. This is one of the major accusations. I say, hey, look, there is no such thing as threat, and I don't need threat anymore. Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead. Okay, very important. Let those who want to identify threat, let them be the ones who want to identify threat. Otherwise, there'd be no salvation. Everyone just claim, hey, we haven't finished identifying threat. Nobody can go to paradise. That's not fair. That's endless. I say, well, just wait a little longer. No, waiting a little longer is endless. If something's endless, and someone has a basic premise that you need to finish, and it's endless, saying wait a little longer until we finish, or help us out a little longer until we finish, the desire is to finish. So you have to say no to that. That is bogus to say that you're selfish. It's not true. Really, the ones that are staying are actually prideful, spiritual pride. This is a very area of extreme contention here. And certainly many have suffered from this horribly, saying you got no right to be free of threat assessment because you have to help us. What do you mean? I'm free. Everyone's free. You can't say that. That's a delusion of Mother Nature too. There's some process. You're part of this process. No, I'm not part of any process. Nobody's part of any process. That's a hallucination. And you're free to keep hallucinating if you want to. But I'm free to not buy into the hallucination. I'm free to, you know, for paradise. Absolutely. And of course, those who want to keep assessing threat will not agree with that. They'll say, no, you're threatening our success. Again, more threat. You're threatening our success of assessing threat by claiming there is no threat. But that's the attitude of this world. It's the attitude of this world. That's why Jesus said they'll hate you. You know, those who follow Jesus, they'll say the world will hate you for sure. Absolutely, it does hate that. They're not pulling their weight. See, we need everyone pulling on that rope of threat assessment in order to actually be able to finally determine where our threat to reality actually is effective in, you know, in this chaos. There is no threat. Reality is not threatened. And There is no threat to reality. Only reality is real. And again, you cannot bring miracles into this world. So like I'm being forced to live in a situation, you know, which is just absolutely horrific for me. I don't believe in process. So I always think, like, when something breaks, I says, fix it. You know, why should I fix it? I'll just have it appear to be the way it was before. And that's always the way I felt. I feel everything should just be exactly the way I want it to be in terms of appearance-wise. It's all appearance. If something's dead, I do, you know, they say, well, oh, well, it's just an appearance. Okay, let's have it appear to be alive again. So I'm not able to really, I've never bought into this world, never bought into it. But people completely freak out if you think that way at all. It freaks them out. Well, those are what's called, Jesus called the dead. The dead. Believing in death, believing in process, believing in threat. It's all a complete pretension, complete dream hallucination, that we're just arbitrarily insisting on this pretense of process, of time and space. There goes the house down the river. That's a process in time and in space, distance. Distance, duration. The house was there, now it's there. No, nothing's changed. It's all an appearance. You can't say appearances change in terms of the laws of appearance. If you don't want that appearance, then you have the house appear back where it was before. The laws of appearance don't change at all. And the law of appearance is freedom. So you can never change freedom in spite of what this hallucination we think that we have. We have not. But those who want to play that they're greater than God, you know, fine. I'm not interested in playing that. It's a play of suffering. And God is certainly not interested in having me play that game. We're free to do so. But, you know, God is not saying, well, God says, sure, you're free. Equal love to all. Yes. But at the same time, God knows that we're very dissatisfied with this. So God did not create us to dwell in dissatisfaction forever, you see. So God certainly aligns with our deepest desire, which is to drop this nonsense. But again, we have this continuity fear. Severe continuity fear. Fear of chaos if we don't identify threat, you see. So it is, repentance is required. Repentance is required. Awareness of the continuity situation, whatever you want to call it, is required. Awareness of the intermediate step is required. There's certain, the Holy Spirit will educate everybody. I say, and look, the Holy Spirit will educate you so you'll know exactly what I know now. And to realize that it's completely bogus that you have to stay here. That's utterly bogus. Or that it's, you're selfish or sinful. That's totally bogus. It is not. I'm actually giving you a great example of what you'll have to follow eventually. By going to paradise. So again, keep full stopping the information. Otherwise, it's going to get too much dust in the air, right? Like, wow, how do I? No, just let the information come in, full stop with permeation. You don't try to interfere with the permeation of it by kicking up a whole bunch of questions and dialogue and thoughts and disagreements and devil's advocate and different positions and all this kind of stuff. You don't need to do any of that. Don't switch into devil advocate mode at all. When you're hearing truth, don't jump into devil's advocate mode at all. Refuse to do that. Refuse to do that. Otherwise, you're just going to completely, you know, you're going to basically you say, well, let me see how I can threaten what you just said, that kind of thing. That's a desire for threat again, isn't it? Let me see how I can threaten that. Don't threaten it. Nothing real can be threatened. Nothing unreal exists. So we have this severe continuity problem. And so we got to treat the continuity problem correctly You don't just say, well, how can I threaten my acceptance of that I have a continuity problem? No, you don't want to do that. That's counterproductive. It's counterproductive. It just throws you right back into the hallucination. So certainly, we do have this one problem of a continuity issue. So we have to be very wise and disciplined in treating this problem. There's no question about it. I don't know anybody who's more disciplined than I am and determined in terms of, you know, I just watch my every thought and action. I'm just very, very intensely disciplined and serious because I know this continuity problem is very severe and the situation of getting free of this madness here is very difficult. So, absolutely, you know, you have to be disciplined and be very intelligent about what you're doing in terms of doing what works. I would say very pragmatic. Instead of intelligent, I say super pragmatic. You have to be super pragmatist. So don't play the devil's advocate. Just rule that out. Say, forget it. That's gone. I'm not going to do that anymore. Very important. What you have to do is you simply have to trust in the Holy Spirit that it will deliver the clarity to you when you're ready for it. The Holy Spirit absolutely knows everything you need to know. And it's not holding it back. It is simply waiting until you're ready to receive it. So under no circumstances do you, you know, try to be faithless to the Holy Spirit and say, well, I need to raise all these questions now, otherwise they won't be addressed. That is not true. Once you have accepted what the Holy Spirit has said, then it will clarify further. And what I've done with this video channel on YouTube is demonstrate this, is a progressive clarity, see, a progressive clarity taking place. As the continuity fear diminishes, the Holy Spirit continues to then give you more clarity and more clarity, more clarity. As I have not been trying to, you know, intellectually analyze and throw a bunch of questions, I've just been sort of transmitting the clarity as I get it, so you can see that. That's why you say saved by faith. Saved by faith. Faith is to accept the truth that you know it's true and then don't try to interfere with it. See, we're treating the continuity problem here. Don't switch and play devil's advocate and throw a bunch of, you know, questions and try to pressure it. Don't pressure it. Just say, okay, this is enough for now, full stop. I'm just going to allow this to settle in. I accept it, let it settle in. And then the Holy Spirit says, okay, now you're ready for more clarity. And then you get more clarity and it's like, wow, that's fantastic, that is great. Now let that settle in, full stop with that, let that settle in. That's the path. So you may not seem like some great philosopher, dialoguer, you know, writer, all. You may not seem that way at all, actually. You may not seem that way at all. I'm not seen that way around, you know, in my surroundings or life at all. In fact, people see me as not having anything to say at all. I usually don't say anything out and so socially, just bare minimum. Like I'm mentally challenged or something, or just like be quiet and say, oh, you know, I don't really know, and just like I'm a knucklehead for vacant mind or something. Because that discourse is not the way. The way is to listen and hear and accept truth and full stop it and allow it then to grow within you. Grow. Okay. It's like you've got a plant and you water it. You don't like pull the plant by the roots and say, how, let me measure the roots, how much they've grown. Okay, let me stick the plant back in again. You know, keep pulling the plant up or something. Every time you want to water it. No, you just water it and wait. Water it and wait. Water it and wait. That's the way. Thank you. See, now I was extrapolating right there. So I said, stop it. Don't try to be too smart. Don't try to appear to be smart. Be clear about what's being said and let that clarity be within you. But don't try to be smart about it. Get used to that. Get familiar with the clarity that has arrived for you. Don't try to be smart about it. Or smart with it. Just let it settle in, and so then you're ready for the next clarity, greater clarification to arrive. So to the world, you may never appear to be smart, right? How did you get there? You know, you never seem to be very smart to me. I don't, you know, this is some kind of trick or something. You don't need to be smart in that way. You need to be faithful. Faithful to the process of dealing with this continuity problem. Since there is a continuity problem, there is a sort of a process, as it were, spiritual process in dealing with it, which is faith, which is to take what's said on faith, meaning don't try to get Mother Nature to applaud you for it. You see what I'm saying? You know it's true, but don't expect Mother Nature and those who are addicted to this and demanding it be this way for them. Don't expect them to applaud you for it. They most certainly will not. And you get caught up in trying to be smart and explain it to them. You know, it's impossible. They're just wasting your time and energy. It's unrepentant. You have to repent. And they have to go through their own continuity path, you know. Certainly, when you're working your continuity problem, you can pick up from others that are working on it or have worked on it. You'd certainly pick up good advice, good and encouragement and all that. You can pick that up. But you get it like that, like clarity. Oh, I'm clear about that. Then just let that be. Just let it be. Let the clarity just be. Now, meditation periods are very important. When you're dedicated to whatever clarity arises, just let it be. Don't try to be smart about it. And if you do that, then you really make fast progress. Whereas if you get a little insight and you just want to say, oh, I got this little insight, little clarification. I want to go out and see if I can get some applause from the world or something like that. Then it is very slow. Progress is very slow. You may write it in a diary, you may do like these videos like I'm doing, or various ways where you can, you know, share clarity, and it actually helps bring more and more and more. But I find that videos are better than writing, because you can see live the process of needing to, you know, full stop it. Whereas in writing, if someone writes something and shares it, it seems like they just went like this. It is not true. It is not true. I tend to get kind of confused with reading books now at this point. Really do, because you miss the whole process of it. What is the process really like? It's not like that at all. You can get this whole book and you say, wow, somebody just sat down and wrote this book and it's all here. That's not how it is on your path. Your path is daily grind, or daily ordeal. You know, so I find these videos are more important than writing. That's why I've done these videos. I could have written. I've written a lot. I throw it all away. I say, this doesn't give people the right impression at all. Doesn't show them what's really involved at all. Does not. But the videos do. The videos show, this is live. I'm doing this live. And you're seeing the struggle. You're seeing the discipline. You're seeing, you know, the pragmatism of it. Right? What's being transmitted here is spiritual pragmatism. That's what's being transmitted, and you get that way better in videos than you do in any sort of writing. Way, way better. Apparently in the astral realm, what's been reported is that if you want a spiritual teacher to appear, they just appear, and then you can go to where they are, appear where they are. And you're there with them, and so then you actually experience the pragmatism of it. Okay, that's way better than just reading. Way, way better. I tend to have trouble reading now. I really do. Because you can push way too much upon yourself through reading and thinking, well, the author is pushing it upon me because it's all here on the page.
No.
You can overload yourself. Really overload yourself. Or maybe Jesus wants this, the Holy Spirit wants this taping to take place as a really a more advanced form than books. It's way more advanced, actually. So I was willing to do it. Yeah, I was willing to do it having experience in the past of being in the public eye, of doing compositions, composing, being creative, putting my creative effort out to the world, the whole world. I've already done all that. So I was able to do this, even though there's not that many views, about 40 or so per video. At least it's getting done. At least it's getting done. And this is something which will, in the higher realm, so to speak, which where there's less continuity fear, there is a paradise realm, and there's also other realms that have less continuity fear than this one. Like the astral realm, for instance. That they're able to view teachers live, so to speak, wherever you are, on demand. And there's a so some teacher, like for instance, if I happen to be working that way, at some point, be able to appear to however many people want to appear and share the process, the pragmatism with them. Saying this is how you have to go, you know, like that. Now, in some situations like satsang, you have somebody come up who is working through the continuity fear. Let's say you're free of the continuity fear, the teacher. Well, you have someone come up who's working through it, and then they work through it for everybody else, and you kind of like help guide them through that. That's the way that satsang is done with an enlightened teacher. Because they're not struggling through it themselves anymore. But certainly they can, you know, very, very adroitly, you know, point out to those who are there how to use the pragmatism properly, how to use it properly. So you see, in watching these videos, you're getting more advanced than reading books, in my opinion. Way more advanced. Because you're literally seeing the kind of discipline it takes to really, you know, really, truly make progress instead of just intellectual processing everything intellectually. You see a lot of books being written in the world and all of this. A lot of it's, you know, is something that's being processed intellectually and put into a book, and people say, look what I'm able to do, boom, like that. Well, it may have taken them 30 years, you know, to do that, and many, many years to write the book and everything. And you're it's all condensed and flat, you know, it's flat. It's very flat. And that's not, struggling with the continuity fear is not like that. We really do have this severe continuity fear. And it's a dance with this continuity fear. You know, it's a dance. We're dancing with the continuity fear, and you have to be very pragmatic in this dance. You bring something up, it stuns you, it shocks you. You have to manage that. You have to manage your success. It takes time. You have to have patience. You don't just say, give me the book. Oh, I got it. Boom. That's just like our educational system teaching. Okay, I read the book. What are the key points? Okay, I know what the key points are. And okay, I can write an essay on it and get an A on the test. That has nothing to do with the spiritual path. Nothing to do with it. I studied A Course in Miracles for 15 years. Intensely. Read stuff over hundreds and hundreds of times, and just like, wow, wow, wow. Just a struggle. It's been 14 hours a day on it. You know, it's just, wow, what's he saying? It's incredible. It's amazing. Holy cow, is this possible to really accept this here? And There's a dance in the continuity of fear. It's this intricate dance. And pragmatism is all important. And I just learned the difficult way. You know, just wow. Made so many mistakes, just painful mistakes. And now I'm much, much more disciplined. It's been 36 years working on this now. Still make mistakes, of course. The continuity of fear bites everybody. It'll bite you. You give it a chance, it will bite you, for sure. It'll step on your toes. If you don't dance right, it's going to step on your toes. And you're going to get out of whack with, you know, you got out of whack. And it's just like, whoa, there's a problem. You have to be very pragmatic. And I share the pragmatism in these videos above everything else. The content is there, but the pragmatism is even more important. The kind of time that you need to give it. Because really, when you're able to be pragmatic with the continuity of fear and wise about it, you can give hours to this and make incredible progress. Just stunning progress. Just really leaping forward. Jesus always told me, you gotta go faster. In other words, you've got to manage your success. Learn how to manage your success. Learn how to dance with the continuity of fear. With those rationalizations, how to dance with these rationalizations and then evaporate them. And that's how you go fast. Okay, that's how you go fast. Otherwise, you're going to go very slow, too slow, and you won't get escape velocity, as it were. Now, the paradise realm, is that the causal? It could be the causal realm. That is possible. Or it could be the high astral realm or something like that. I'm not sure. From there, it is possible to teach others. Like in the astral realm, it is possible to teach. Sri Yukteswar is in the, I think it may be the causal realm or high astral, but he's teaching in the astral realm now. And he says it's you can actually teach very well there. Well, we'll see. So, it is possible. It is possible. What I'm doing now is some point to function that way, since I'm already used to this now. I've already done it, which is very helpful. Very helpful. Because again, the guru system is better, because you get that living pragmatism. Living pragmatism puts the heat on you, and really helps you go faster than just a flat lining of books. We think we can go faster in books, but we stumble so much. We miss, it's easy to get off track in doing that, very easy. Because your path doesn't go like the way of a book goes. It does not at all. You get a little bit of clarity, and then boom, the continuity of fear starts dancing with it. Dancing, rationalizing, hey, we need to stop here. Rationalizing, we need to stop. And if you just keep forcing your way forward, like within a book, you know, the continuity here builds up, and it may say, hey, that's great, you made a lot of success, now let's take a couple months off. You know, we need to really let this settle down a couple months, you know. And then you lose all your momentum. I experienced this so many times, I lost all my momentum. I said, that's terrible, what's going on here? You don't want to lose your momentum. Your momentum is the most precious thing you have here in this world. So you want to guard it at all costs, even if it means sitting there and doing nothing for a while. Because oftentimes doing something really helps you lose your momentum. You get involved in some project that just blows your momentum to pieces. It's just gone. Then you say, how the heck can I get my momentum going again? It's so difficult. It's like a car. Once you get it started, you're pushing it. It's much easier to keep it going once you've got it started. If you let this car stop, you're like, I need to rest and let it stop. I mean, I need to do something else. You know, then it stops, and then you have to break the inertia again. So what we do is we make sure we're just keeping the car going, so it doesn't, we don't have to break the inertia. So being patient is actually keeping the car going. Your attention is still there. You're not pushing it really fast, but you're keeping it going just enough. So your determination, your focus is still there, but maybe the clarity is, you're just saying, I need a little break from the breakthroughs. Let me stay conscious of the situation. Recognize what the situation you're in. You're in an intense situation. Now you may go watch. I may go watch the baseball game or something, or golf or something. And it's easy to forget. And you know, after a little while, I've suddenly forgotten my momentum, my inertia. What was I thinking? So it's you have to be very careful about that. You have to kind of limit whatever you're doing, just the normal stuff of the day. You kind of just don't get too involved in it. Take a little time and say, I'll walk away from it. I'll go in and watch a couple batters of a baseball game, and then I'll walk away, and I'll get back and focus on what I'm doing, and then I'll go in maybe a little and watch a few more, and I'll go away from it. Try not to get engrossed in any worldly situation. Don't get engrossed in it. Do not get engrossed in it. Which is why I don't attend events. Like, I don't go to baseball games, because then you get all engrossed in the emotionalism, the whole crowd's like totally engrossed in it. And then it really breaks your momentum badly. Same thing with drugs. You get totally engrossed in the drug experience. Breaks your momentum severely. You know. All sorts of stuff in the world. Don't get engrossed in it at all. Stay detached from worldly events and situations. Very detached. You can, take a look at, look at a couple holes of golf. Oh, that's nice. And then don't get detached, engrossed in the storyline. You know, try not to. That'll really slow you down. And you don't want to be slowed down right now, because the world is not slowing down in terms of threat assessment. Keep in mind, in order to stack up a lot of merits in threat assessment, as it were, status, you need a lot of threats, right? The world says, how can we advance if we don't have a lot of threats? Since we've tackled this threat, and this threat, and this threat, so we need something even more. The world is always more threat. You know, we need more threat. I mean, you may think like fourth dimensional Venus is free of threat. No, they're not. They see this world here as an extreme threat to them, especially atomic energy. And pollution, they say, wow, you can ruin our world. And so they view us as an incredible threat. So you may think, that life on fourth dimensional Venus is so wonderful. Well, along comes this horrible threat of planet Earth. And so they're just like really engrossed in trying to, identify this threat that we pose to them, you see. So in fourth dimension is not an escape from threat at all. It's just the threats get bigger, more difficult to deal with. Imagine the headaches we are for Venus, fourth dimensional Venetians. This world is just like a nightmare for them. How do we fix this place up, We want peace on this earth, Gosh darn it, you're really causing us troubles. But keep in mind that the universe is just a threat generator. Mother Nature's a threat generator. So the world is generating worse threats. I bring up ISIS as an example, or ISIL, and we thought we got rid of this terrible threat for world peace, Al-Qaeda, and now something pops up is even worse, 10 times worse. we thought we got rid of, illnesses, up pops Ebola, 10 times worse. This is like horrible. The possibilities are, quite frightening, actually, in many ways. So this is the world. This is our situation. This is hell. This is hell. Welcome to hell. You should realize you're living, dwelling in a hellish hallucination, a hellish agreement, an agreement that you believe in hell, that hell is possible, that we're dwelling in this agreement of process. And we don't need to. We don't need to. There's no need to. No need, actual need for it whatsoever. We repent, and there's no need for it. If we don't repent, then it will appear as if there's a desperate need for it, for sure. But it's not a need that reality of reality. It's a need because we're trying to displace reality, right? But we don't need to displace reality. So it's not really a need. But it certainly seems that way, doesn't it? So managing your own path is where it's all at. That's where it's all at. If you don't do that, you won't succeed. If you do it right, keep being pragmatic, then you're going to realize that, wow, I am making progress. I am making progress here. with my continuity fear. I am evaporating it. And, you know, it's going pretty fast. It's going pretty fast here, actually. Never as fast as we like. Because, wow, do I have to keep going through this ordeal another day? Come on. Well, yeah, the continuity fear is very severe. But it sure beats dwelling in hell for a long time, doesn't it? Absolutely it does. I mean, I'm thinking longer. But if I didn't do this, I'd be dwelling in hell for a long, 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 long time. So it's a great deal. You know, you put in the effort, however long it takes, to free yourself from the delusion of hell, the hellish delusion, the agreement, the hellish agreement, hellish false necessity of assessing threat, and you're free. Whereas if you don't do it, you're still completely bound by thinking this is all really, there's no escape. You have to try to gain status through assessing threat, and you just go on and 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 on like that. And you think you're making advancements, you think you're making, okay, I'm really better at assessing threat now, you know, I need another life, another life, another life, another life, another life. You know, it's just endless trying to attain status, it's all a dead end. So, that's a terrible deal there, that's a bad deal. Don't make the deal with the devil. The devil is just this, means our collective agreement that we're going to believe that this pretense of process is real. Okay, that this, and then, that's just our collective agreement, actually. So don't make a deal with our collective agreement to continue to believe in it. You don't need, there's no need for that. No need for it. The Holy Spirit will take care of all time and space, whatever adjustments need to be made as we drop our continuity fear. The Holy Spirit will make those adjustments for us automatically. It's automatic. Now, the term Jesus Christ is just is a symbol for no continuity fear, no agreement with hell, no agreement to believe that it is that this is anything other than hallucination, no agreement to say there's necessity to it. All right, that's what that terminology. That's a way that we refer to it. It can be referred to however we want to, simply pragmatism, Holy Spirit, continuity fear, paradise. Whatever, but there's a, you know, it's not automatically get you into paradise, but what it does, it's a way to people to say, hey, no, I'm taking the path of faith in Jesus Christ, meaning I'm the path of clarity, because obviously if somebody is still deluded, they cannot transmit clarity to you. If the Holy Spirit transmits clarity to us, because it's not deluded at all. So, and then the path of faith means to hear it and accept it, without trying to interfere with it, right? We know it's true, but we also know the continuity fear of this place is so gigantically severe that unless you're repentant, you're not going to accept this. So we don't try to force truth on anyone here. Therefore, we don't have to figure out how to force it upon others. We just accept it for ourselves and just have faith that the Holy Spirit will clarify for others when they need it also. Like that. For example, the whole time I did a study on Course in Miracles, I never mentioned it to anybody. One person just sort of tangentially in a conversation that I just let it drop and never said it. Other than that, never ever did I say, no one had the slightest idea I was ever studying it. Never. Nobody. The Holy Spirit says, don't share it. Don't talk about it. Don't talk about it. I said, wow, okay. Because the continuity fear it was still so strong that I would have been easily pulled into academic discussions, you know, like that. even now, I don't discuss the taping. Most people don't know I'm taping at all. Again, get pulled into academic discussion. Why are you doing this? Won't justify it, blah, blah, blah. No. See, the unrepentant want justification of what's the process here? How are you helping us identify threat? And it's not about that. It's about faith in clarity. Because of our continuity fear, it's about pragmatism, spiritual pragmatism of those who have repented. So you can't explain it to them. It's not possible. But you see, they want to assess what kind of threat you are to them. That's all they're interested in. That's what I found out. When you talk about spiritual matters to those who are unrepentant, all they want to assess is what kind of threat are you to them. But you're actually not a threat to them at all. But remember, their whole purpose is to assess threat. So they can feel as if you're not interested in assessing threat. That they feel is a threat to them. So it's better not to bother them with it, actually. So Jesus, Holy Spirit, don't get involved, you know, with groups and talking about it. Just do it. All right, just do it. And let others just do what they're doing. Now, hopefully this taping is a sign of some maturity and evaporating of a continuity fear on my part. But still, I don't dialogue with anyone. Because again, it always deteriorates into how much of a threat is this? You see, our continuity fear is so severe. It is so severe. That's why I advocate any sort of sharing in this world has to have some structure to it, or else it will definitely disintegrate into a dance with the continuity fear. You know, it's like, how do I, you know, it disintegrates into a sense of threat. For sure, it does. Whatever talks or conversations I've had in my life with people about this matter, spiritual matters, always disintegrates into at least some sense of threat. In one way or the other. So that's not the way. That is not the way. Casual discussion is never the way. Casual dialogue is never the way. If you look at a satsang, like for instance, Muji is a good example of a satsang, and you know, he's there, and then someone comes up, and they are then in the role of symbolizing the spiritual path and the necessity for spiritual pragmatism. And then Muji's coaching them, you know, he asks a question. It's basically just a way to get to coach. You know, he's a coach. And people pick up on that and say, okay, this is a good way. They pick up pointers of how to manage their success. It's not just some free-flowing dialogue, you know, and it's not like that. That's not the way. That is not, dialogue is not the way. Muji's not just having a casual conversation in a coffee shop or something. That's not it. And we romanticize it, thinking, oh yeah, that's the way. No, it's not. No. You have to give the tools to people to manage their success. You have to assess them. How are they managing their success? Because that's where it's all what it's all about is the management of success. That's what it's all about. Pragmatism. And so in order to do that, you need to take somebody through enough time with full stop, get the information, full stop, get the information, full stop, as Muji would say, don't answer that, you know. Muji is a spiritual coach. You know, how good is he? I don't know. You know how to compare it, but certainly he has some you know abilities at that. You know, there's no question he has some coaching abilities. And there are many that have coaching abilities to you know greater or lesser extent. Many. Muji's on YouTube, so people are aware of him. And he does coach. He does coach. And how good is he? How's he? I don't know. I'm not measuring. Like, try not to measure it. I'd say, he does his coaching. Yeah. And that's just what happens. Is this coaching? So the one who comes up on the hot seat has to be aware. They're aware of you know, some insight. They're aware of this, and then they say, well, okay, how do you deal with your success? How are you dealing with the success? So what you really want is somebody to come up there who's had this breakthrough or something, and then help them, you know, say, how do I manage this? How do I manage this breakthrough? And gradually people get this overall sense of, yeah, spiritual pragmatism. So it does, it helps everybody who comes to satsang, for somebody, you know, these examples, and they pay attention. They say, wow, I had a similar situation, and you pick up pointers like that. So there is effectiveness to it. There is effectiveness to satsang. There's no question about it. There is a role for spiritual coaches, coaching like that. And, you know, so, and every coach has a different style. Every coach is, it's all unique. You know, it's just whatever coaching is available, whatever's help you can get. And I get my coaching, have gotten it through studying the lives of some teachers. That's helped through the Holy Spirit, through trial and error. I never got it through satsang. I really attended satsang. Actually, I have not. But, you know, there's other different ways you could get it. It's just, for me, it's just my situation was just tremendous amount of determination and work and trial and error and studying the lives of saints and how they dealt with it somehow. And then watching videos, too. I mean, I picked up some pointers from Buji. I picked up pointers from hundreds of teachers, actually. I've watched a lot of different teachers' videos and books and videos of a lot of different teachers. And you know, you get something from everyone. You pick up something like, hey, that's a very useful, you know. Don't answer that question. Don't try to get it. Don't try to get it. I'm not asking you a question to answer like that, you know. No teacher, no teaching, no student. Bunjaji, I picked up pointers from him, you know. So you pick up pointers along the way. So a teacher is not going to enlighten you. The teacher is going to help you, coach you as how can you manage your path? How do you manage your path? That's usually the case. How can you manage? You're going to succeed, but the success is just incredible. I mean, the success is just fantastic. It's beyond anything we can imagine, almost, you know. How are you going to manage your continuity fear? How do you manage it? That should be foremost in your awareness. Don't just say, oh, Guru, I'm going to be enlightened. Enlighten me, Guru. You know? Well, they might have a peak experience in that. How do you manage that? You know, they're saying, give me a fish, Guru. And the Guru says, no, let me teach you how to fish. Let me teach you how to fish here. That's way more important. Gotta be careful of the beggars. A lot of devotionals are like beggars. Give me a peak experience. I want a peak experience. And they just keep begging and begging and begging. They never learn how to manage their own path. It's essential. Because the breakthroughs are, as we've seen here in the video, just huge. It's just huge. All of nature, I was explaining, the whole universe is just a hallucination. All a process. There's no process. No such thing. You know, these are gigantic insights. And we're able to just accept them. I am least them, and just like, great, yeah. Because I'd be able to manage the path. I know how to manage it, you see. A devotional person might get this. Oh my God, my great guru, my great teacher gave me this insight. Go around telling everybody, hey, you gotta go see this teacher. Hey, you gotta go see this teacher. Oh my God, you. This is just a sort of a stereotypical example. Now, no, some devotion, path of devotion can work too, but that has to be managed expertly as well, you see. So so no matter what, you have to spend enough time and focus on it to manage it moment by moment. It's a dance with the continuity fear, and the continuity fear, you know, is really severe. You can't just push it around. You know, it's going to be pushing you around. You push it a little bit, it pushes back. Okay, that's like that. Well, we've just pushed a lot here. We've pushed a lot. We've pushed really severely, haven't we? Extreme push today and yesterday and the day before and the day before and the day before and year after year, every day. But extreme push today is no exception. It is an extreme push today. We're talking about paradise. We're talking about paradise. We're talking about being freeing ourselves for paradise here. We're talking about we don't need Mother Nature at all. We don't need that experiencing anymore. Don't need it. It's all phony anyway. Completely phony. See, these are gigantic breakthroughs. So, and yet, we're able to just manage it and say, fine, that's great. Just let it settle in. Just take, so let the faith settle in. Let faith be your action on it. Just faith be your action on it. Because you know it's true. You know, the Spirit will say, oh, this is true. This is true. Okay. So, getting a feel of managing your path is fantastically helpful. You're never going to be get to the huge insights and be able to really accept it unless you're able to manage this and just feel comfortable with it and say, okay. All right, that's good. That's good. It's a big deal and it's also not a big deal. It's both. Don't get engrossed in the world. Do not get engrossed in the world, which is something I tell myself all the time. After this, I'm probably going to say, wow, how can I get engrossed in the world? You know, this is like this intensity is so amazing. You know, it's, I have to say, no, don't get engrossed in the world. Just give it time, this time to settle in. Just let it settle in. It's like you have a visitor. You'd be very hospitable. Here's, show them their room, you know, some food, whatever. Just let them settle in. Let them settle in. Don't pester your guest when they come. You really, these insights are like a very cherished guest. I mean, it's like super fortunate, good fortune to have these clarifications come to you. And so treat them like an honored guest, absolutely honored guest. Oh my gosh, this is fantastic. This guest came to my house today. Let, you know, treat them like royalty, but don't pester, right? Once they've come in, let them settle down. Let them feel comfortable. And you just go on about your day and just let them settle in. And then once you've done that, then you'll feel comfortable about their presence here in your house. So in the house of your thoughts and thinking and ideas and beliefs. And so they stay. They stay, right? You don't like pester them with dialogue and questions and everything. Just say, wow, I'm so glad you came here. It's fantastic. Thank you for coming. This is terrific. So treat insights like honored guests coming to your house. Give them the space for them to be quiet and let them settle in. All right, so I'm going to do that right now. All right, very great. That's it.